Welcome, everyone. I'm Todd Singer, head of BMO's Diversified Industries Group. I'd like to thank you for your interest in today's event. One of our key principles at BMO is adding value to our clients through thought leadership. In some conversation each day, we are confident that you are talking about COVID-19 variants, labor challenges, surging inflation, rising interest rates, and how long will this economic recovery last? In today's discussion, we are excited for our speaker to share his views on all of these topics. We are hopeful that you will find value in the information presented. Before I introduce our speaker, I want to address a few housekeeping items. Feel free to ask a question at any time during today's presentation. You will see a Q&A box located on the right-hand side of your video monitor where you can enter a question and simply click Ask the button. The questions are confidential and not seen by anyone but our presenter. Today's event is being recorded and will be shared following today's conversation. And now for a brief introduction on our speaker. Michael Gregory is Deputy Chief Economist and Head of U.S. Economics for BMO Capital Markets. He manages our team responsible for forecasting and analyzing the North American economy and financial markets. Michael, as always, a big thanks for you being here today. And with that said, over to you.
All right, thanks, Todd, and hello, everybody, and welcome. I'm going to be talking for about 45 minutes in this presentation, or maybe a little bit less than that, and we'll have time for a Q&A session afterwards. So as Todd mentioned, please enter your questions. Some of you have already asked some questions when you registered, and I did see those, and in fact, I tried to incorporate some of the answers actually into my presentation, so hopefully I'll be able to address them then. All right, so let's just start off. The title of my talk, Inflation Infection. I thought it was an appropriate title given we're still living with COVID, but more importantly, increasingly living with rising inflation. But before we begin, it's important to take stock where we are right now. So if you go to the first slide, please. All right, well, you know, we just recently got some information on the fourth quarter for GDP. We grew 6.9% annualized. Exceptionally strong result. And we've already sort of made up all the ground lost during the recession by the second quarter of last year. And now we've almost made up all the ground left to get back on the trend that we would have been on if not for the recession. The question is, are we going to get past that line in the first quarter? We probably need growth at around 4% to actually what economists call close the output gap. We don't think we'll quite get there in the first quarter. The first quarter is looking kind of challenging, and we'll see that actually with the job numbers that are due on Friday. They'll be for January, and we're expecting not a very impressive number. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if we had a slight negative because we're at this point now where some of the headwinds affecting the economy are starting to be felt a little bit more severely now. They're temporary, but they're still being felt. Next slide, please. Well, of course, the biggest headwind that we've been living with now for, I believe that's been over 2 years. The first case was reported in January of 2020. So it's been like 2 years in the making. The good news is the Omicron wave does seem to be subsiding substantially. Cases are still elevated. A lot of people are still getting sick, but hospitalizations are down, and with some lag, so too will death. So, and this was, not as severe in terms of health outcomes as previous waves. As long as we stay the course here, this will become less and less of an impediment for economic activity. If you go to the next slide, please. But Omicron, despite the fact we didn't have any restrictions this wave, still was a damper on activity. And we see that most profoundly in terms of absenteeism. You know, the Census Bureau rather, did a survey that went from the end of December till around January 10th. And they concluded some 8.8 million Americans were absent because either they were sick with COVID or they were caring for somebody that was sick. And that's how profound the impact was. That was having an impact on production. It was having an impact on the availability of goods on the store shelves, which I'm sure some of you just see on a day-to-day basis. So it did have an impact despite the fact there were no restrictions. Plus people, were imposing their own restrictions on their own behaviors. We saw seated diners actually fall quite noticeably over the last several weeks. People are flying less, and that's not because they can't fly or they can't dine out. They choose not to because of the pandemic. And on top of that, we still have the lingering impact of the case rates in other countries that is affecting global supply chain. So overall, the economy is feeling the impact of Omicron, despite there are no restrictions, and we have to get over that before we can look ahead to stronger growth for the remainder of this year. Next slide, please. Well, in the meantime, we've seen inflation just soar. The primary catalyst for that has been the bottlenecks that we've been experiencing primarily for the past year or so. We happen to think, the kind of rates we're seeing now, by the way, we're looking at 40-year highs in terms of inflation, at least for headline inflation at 7%. Core inflation at 5.5% isn't quite a 40-year high. Technically, it's a 30-year high, but we're only a tenth away from hitting that 40-year high. And we suspect that we'll get there in the months ahead because it doesn't look like inflation has yet peaked. Part of that is the impact of Omicron on exacerbating labor shortages and product shortages. Part of that is the fact we had very strong momentum heading out of last year. If you look at the last 3 months of the year, headline inflation was running at around a 9% annualized rate. Core inflation was running about a 7% annualized rate. And so that's the kind of strong momentum we have. Combine that with Omicron's impact on bottlenecks. And finally, the old nemesis for inflation, oil prices are drifting up as well. We're pushing $90 and the highs we haven't seen since 2014 before prices collapsed. The good news is that we will likely see inflation crest in the months ahead. And as the temperatures warm up, the snow melts, depending on where you are in the country, and Omicron cases continue to subside, which I think they will, I think inflation is also going to come down a bit, simply because last spring, we had these huge spikes in prices because of reopening. In this year, we're not going to get them. Therefore, when you compare on a year-to-year basis, inflation will be marked down. But the one thing I wanted to leave you with before we continue here is a lot of people, they think about bottlenecks pushing up inflation. They think only on the supply side of the equation, constrained supply, whether it's because of the pandemic or whatever. But there's another dimension to these bottlenecks, and it's demand. And one of the themes I'm going to leave you with today is that it is this demand side that has also exacerbated inflation. If demand wasn't as strong as it was, even if you have constrained supply, the bottleneck pressures on inflation would not be as profound. But it's because we also had strong demand that we had these issues. Next slide, please. And I think, if you want to sort of focus on this sort of mix of demand and supply putting up inflation, you can look no further than, the impact of the shortage of semiconductors or microchips on automobile prices. Now, we all know that they're an important part of vehicles these days. And because of the shortage, we've ended up with a limited supply. You drive by any dealer lot. You're starting to get a little filled up again now, but for a while there, we're looking pretty bare. And so that's bid up the price of new vehicles. People are often paying not only the full sticker price, but there's usually some surcharges and things attached to that. So people are paying above list in many cases for new vehicles. And needless to say, when you have limited supply of new vehicles, people turn to the new used segment, and we've seen a spike in prices there. And even though it's sort of fallen off a little bit, it's starting to heat up yet again. And the important thing is here that even though there was constrained supply of both new and used vehicles at the same time, which is why the prices were going up, the fact is demand for vehicles was also pretty strong. People were driving instead of taking transit. And you know, people had a little bit more cash in the bank, and you know, instead of going on a trip or doing something, traveling overseas or something like that, they were buying vehicles or wanted to buy vehicles. And so the demand was there, constrained supply. And again, this, the same sort of thing was affecting on the rental car segment as well, where, you know, around last summer, we had a near 100% increase in rental car fees. Again, the fleets misjudged how strong demand would come back, and we're caught flat-footed a bit, and we're trying, you know, to get, you know, new vehicles just like everyone else was out there. And as a result, they became in short supply, and prices went up. Well, if you go to the next slide, please. But you think about sort of microchips, you know, they're not just, you know, an issue for the auto sector. They're an issue for many products throughout the economy, including all the sort of consumer products and smart appliances that we all have in our homes these days. And that's something to keep in mind. It was quite ubiquitous in terms of the impact this shortage was on the availability, not just of vehicles, but of many goods throughout the economy. And also importantly, is to keep in mind, this wasn't just about the pandemic affecting, you know, production of microchips. You know, even before we had the pandemic, we had another thing we were worrying about, was the, you know, the trade war between China and the United States. And part of that, you know, had the United States restricting exports into the U.S. Of microchips from China. And another dimension of this shortage, again, beyond the pandemic and beyond the trade war, was climate change. You know, our extreme weather events. You know, we had the ice storm in Texas, that freaky ice storm, which affected, you know, the global supply chain. But more profoundly, we've had a massive drought in Taiwan, where 2/3 of the world's microchips are actually manufactured. And as some of you may know, it takes an awful lot of water to make microchips. And as a result, we've had this impact where even though the demand for chips have gone up, because the demand for the products that have the chips in them have gone up, the supply hasn't been there, and we've been working with razor thin supplies on hand. And when those, you know, any kind of disruption out there anywhere, it ends up choking off the production process, and we end up with the kind of shortages we're seeing now. Next slide, please. All right, so you know, you think about, well, it's microchips affecting automobiles and other products, but it's not just microchips. It's inputs of anything you can think of have seemed to be in relatively short supply, whether it's raw materials or, you know, semi-finished materials that go into construction and things like that. All of them have been in relatively short supply, in part, you know, mostly due to the pandemic. And in fact, because of that, we've seen producer prices surge to elevated levels on the raw material side. We had record highs recently, just topping over 60% on a year-over-year basis for the full array of raw materials. And when we talk about record highs, you know, the PPI dates back to 1946. And when you look at sort of semi-finished goods, the inputs to production, you know, apart from a brief period in 74, 75, this too is the highest inflation rates we've seen since the end of the Second World War. And of course, you know, this is like pressure in the pipeline that's going to continue to get unleashed on consumers to the extent it can. Next slide, please. Well, you know, we talk about the input of input prices, you know, affecting going up and putting pressure on margins of companies. But, you know, not only is it getting more expensive to make goods, it's also getting a lot more expensive to distribute those goods. We saw at one point this summer where the cost of shipping a container on, you know, typically around the world had jumped more than 500% on a year-over-year basis. And, you know, that's come down, but yeah, now they're only growing, doubling. I mean, that's still a remarkable increase that we are seeing. And at the same time, even shipping goods domestically via truck has escalated to levels we haven't seen at all before. Now, no, one of the issues that was causing these kind of pressures were the log jams we were having at the ports, which the administration worked with the ports themselves and the unions there to try and get them working 24/7, which has alleviated some of the problem. But folks, the longshoremen's contract come due on July 1st. So historically, there are always a little bit of a slowdown in activity heading into those contract negotiations. And the American Trucking Association, you know, has said that, you know, they have a record high 80,000 shortage of truckers. So you know, again, you know, we're dealing with these bottlenecks, but there's, you know, it's going to happen slowly. And a lot of these bottlenecks are going to remain in place, you know, through the remainder of this year. Next slide. All right. So talk about distribution costs, talk about input costs. Well, the other thing we have to deal with are labor costs. And not only are getting, you know, materials in you know, hard time because of shortages, so too is labor. You know, right now there is some, you know, just 10.9 million job openings across the country. Yes, we backed off from the record high of 11.1 we had a while ago, but still, that's an unprecedented level. You know, when you think about, there's just about under, just over 6 million people officially unemployed across the country. In other words, there's like 1.7 jobs available for everyone who's officially looking for a job. Now, of course, there's a skills mismatch problem there, so you really can't look at that. But it gives you a sense how much, you know, how tight those labor markets are. And when you look at sort of other business surveys, particularly among independent and small businesses, they too are reporting, you know, record high levels of vacancies and inability to get the people in the door. Next slide, please. And I don't have to tell anybody on this call, you know, not only is it hard attracting workers, retaining them is also an issue. People are calling this the Great Resignation, where we're seeing tremendous amount of churn in the labor market. The latest figures we have are that 4.3 million people quit their jobs in the latest month. That's December. That's not quite the 4.4 million record high we had, but still, that's an elevated level. You know, employees are feeling emboldened these days. When you look at the Conference Board's labor market differential, which is a gauge of perception of how strong the labor market is and how easy it is to find a job, and you know, that's pushing out near record highs, apart from that brief period around the tech bubble. In other words, for many workers, most workers, these are the strongest labor market conditions they have experienced in their lives. And as a result, many are taking advantage. When I talk to businesses and they talk about keeping, you know, workers on the assembly line, and, you know, it's not even a case now of workers leaving for a dollar or two per hour. You're hearing, you know, cases of $5 and $10 more per hour. So you know, and of course, this further adds to the buildup of cost pressures and presumably inflation pressures down the road. Next slide, please. All right. So this begs the question, and I think someone asked that in the when they signed up. You know, so where have all the workers gone? You know, we've got the output is higher than it was before, but you know, the labor force is still what it was before. It's actually grown a little bit since the pandemic. So where are all the workers gone? Well, one thing is clear is that the labor force participation rate has fallen quite sharply, and it has been very slow to rebound. To put this into some perspective, if we had the same participation rate we had before the pandemic, and allowing, of course, for the fact the population's grown a little bit, you know, we would have the labor force would be almost 4 million people larger than it is right now. Now, the government surveys through the Bureau of Labor Statistics, they show that about 1.1 million people say, and these are people who were either working before the pandemic or were looking for work before the pandemic, have stopped looking, therefore they're not included in the labor force anymore. 1.1 million say it's because of the pandemic. They've got, you know, caregiving issues, they've got health concerns. So it begs the question, that other 2.8 million, where do they go? Well, I do think that the amount of people who are reporting is due to the pandemic is probably underreported. Other surveys suggest that number is a lot bigger than just the 1.1 million. But the larger factor appears to be early retirements. You know, there doesn't seem to be, you know, for you know, people that are 55 and over, more of them are retiring before they reach, you know, 65 or whatever than had been the case previously. You know, perhaps you know, until very recently, those retirement nest eggs were nicely well padded, and of course, you know, older workers perhaps they'll have a little more concern with respect to their health during a pandemic. You know, there's another theme that's sort of unfolded as well, where we've seen this migration, you know, of people moving to more affordable housing, often out of the urban into sort of suburban areas or even exurban areas, that is often or sometimes been associated with moving from two-income households down to one-income household. in part because of childcare concerns and things like that. So, you know, it's obviously related to the pandemic. The question is, how soon or how permanent are these themes? The other thing to keep in mind is that, you know, up until, you know, these benefits end, we had some pretty generous, you know, income support programs that a lot of people, you know, were able, you know, even when those programs ended and we didn't see this rush of people returning back to the labor force, you know, maybe we're going to live off their bank accounts for a little while or be a little more picky about what jobs they would pick if they were looking at all. Next slide, please. The other thing I want to leave with you too is that when you think about labor force participation, you also think about also the population itself, because it's that labor force participation that's applied to the population. And even, you know, America's population is actually in the last year only grew 0.3%, the slowest rate in 70 years. Now, unfortunately, part of that was due to an increase in deaths, you know, either due to the pandemic, COVID pandemic, or to the opioid epidemic. And both of those took a toll on population growth in the U.S., but also has weighed down population growth, has been reduced immigration flows, legal immigration flows. Presumably that means illegal immigration flows too. And it's not just 1 year. If you look at 5 and 10 year trends, so you kind of smooth out what we've seen in 2020 and 2021, the fact is that we are still having the slowest population growth we've seen in some 5 to 10 years, and since the 1950s, either on a 5 year trend or a 10 year trend. So this is a problem that's not going to go away anytime soon. And it's a problem that, as you see from this chart, is pumping up wages. When you look at some key metrics, you know, we're seeing the kind of wage inflation rates we haven't seen since the 1980s. Notice, you know, we've got the highest inflation rates we've seen since, you know, 40 years. And we're now seeing the highest wage inflation rates we've seen in the 1940s. Wages and prices both going up, folks. We know what that's called. We're going to talk about it in a second. If you look at sort of those metrics I just threw down, jotted down on that slide, the one as an economist that bothers me the most are unit labor costs. Unit labor costs can measure broad wages in the economy, but they adjust for productivity. And these, when you kind of look what's happening now, is that wages are growing above and beyond the gains we're seeing in productivity in the economy as a trend basis. And one of the wages that are most closely correlated with inflation are unit labor costs. So it does seem that we are starting to see, you know, a germination here of a wage price spiral in the economy. Next slide, please. And in fact, you know, when you take a look at small business surveys, independent business surveys, you are seeing record high levels of firms that are either raising their wages or plan to raise their wages. And on the other side, raising their prices or planning to raise their prices. In other words, what we're seeing now is a change in behavior, an inflation type behavior setting in. You know, businesses are trying to protect their margins, which is expected. And, and feeling a little more emboldened than they would have about the ability to do that because their competitors are doing it too. And this is something that I think over the past several months has really begun to worry the Fed. And it's not only behavior. If you go to the next slide, actual expectations of what inflation is going to be in the future have also gone up. It's gone up as what it's priced into the bond market, and it's gone up, compared to, you know, what the consumers are thinking about. And this is increasingly factoring in, as I mentioned before, into behavior. Now, it's not like people are expecting inflation to be high for a very long time, but for the next year, two or three, there is this expectation that we have now entered this period where inflation will be elevated compared to where we were for the past few years. Next slide, please. All right. Now, so far, I've talked about sort of the bottleneck creating inflation and then the supply aspect of that. But I want to focus a bit on that demand side. Now, when you think about what's gone on since this pandemic, there's been an awful lot of government support, income support that many, many people needed, many families needed, and many other families, you know, didn't need it as much as that first group. At the same time, most Americans were able to continue working during the pandemic. Some couldn't, and that's unfortunate, but most could. So here you have a situation. Most people are earning the kind of incomes they had before, topped off with the government's largesse. And at the same time, the ability to spend that income was restrained either because of restrictions or because of product shortages or because of just choosing not to until the pandemic goes away. And the net result has been this huge buildup of excess savings. Excess, what I mean by excess is that, you know, consumers were saving about 7.5% of their income before the pandemic. And if you assume they would have continued doing that, anything above and beyond that is an excess. And guess what? That's kind of totaled some $2.4 trillion over the past couple of years. And that's more than 10% of the economy. And the question is, how much of that is actually available to be spent and continue to fuel demand? We know some of this is flipped in or moved into the housing market in terms of down payment. Some of it is moved into permanent savings into the stock market and other, you know, retirement savings and things like that. The question is, how much money is really out there? It's interesting that lately we started to see consumers begin to tap those excess savings just a bit. If you go to the next slide, we're not sure how much liquidity is still out there. Well, and rather than look at household balance sheets, we'll look at my balance sheet, or rather the balance sheet of my employer and all the other financial institutions in the country. And what you find is between businesses and consumers, both, you look at all the deposits that exist within the banking system, plus all that liquidity sitting around in retail money funds, and you finding that, that the total in aggregate is over $4 trillion. That's more than 17% of the economy. And again, this is money in excess of the roughly 7.5% growth we were seeing for these aggregates before the pandemic. This is money that some of it will stay there permanently, but some of it will be used to spend on goods and services. But more importantly, for the Fed, some of that money will be used to keep paying higher prices for longer than would otherwise be the case, because it always is assumed that inflation is always a little bit of a self-correcting phenomena. Inflation goes up, it erodes purchasing power, eventually it dampens demand, but not when there's offsetting wages, which we are seeing, and not when consumers and businesses can tap excess liquidity to keep paying higher wages, higher prices for a lot longer, higher price materials, whatever the case may be. So it does seem that we do have a pretty pressing inflation problem that is risking at least getting out of hand. Next slide, please. Well, in addition to all of this sort of liquidity that's out there, one part of the economy, the government, you know, continues to add its share in terms of spending in the economy. True. We'll probably see the deficit fall this year compared to what it was last year. But those yellow bars you see there are the projections for the CBO. In fact, they're late again in giving their latest projections. They don't include yet the impact of the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, which, you know, is going to add a little bit to the deficit, make those bars a little bit longer. But the more significant part of that is the Build Back Better Act, which was not expected really to, you know, over 10 years to add a lot to the deficit. But as everyone knows, and this is the bone of contention for Senator Manchin in the Senate, is that it's expected to add a lot to the deficit over the next few years. And then as some of these programs are expected to expire, it's going to, you know, improve the deficit in those out years. And that's why, you know, accounting that way has been an issue for that senator. And in fact, we've always accounted for it that way. Forget, folks, those tax cuts that kicked in 2018, you know, for personal taxes, they actually reverse in 3 years' time, according to the law. So, again, that was the method that was used to ensure that that tax cut was fit within budget rules at the time. So apart from, you know, bigger deficits, the more significant impact is all of this spending, apart from adding to pressures in the economy, is also leaving a legacy of very high debt levels. And in fact, it was just reported that the debt clock, in fact, if some of you are in New York City, there's that debt clock in Midtown that you can see, it just rolled past the $30 trillion mark for the first time. We now have more debt than we had, than we did the last high we had, which is in 1946, when we were paying all the bills for the Second World War. So, deficits and debt, not a lot of politicians are talking about it, but hopefully we will get that in the not too distant future. Next slide, please. All right. So, you know, I talk about sort of demand side. We've started to see some changing dynamics on that demand side. Initially, we saw this huge run up in goods demand, in part because people couldn't consume services. So there was a lot of substitution, groceries instead of restaurants, flat screen TVs instead of vacations, that kind of thing. And that's what really added to the pressure we saw on goods prices and inputs to goods production throughout the global economy. But that started to slow down a little bit, in part because we're seeing a natural switch back into services. People are taking vacations instead of buying more flat screen TVs. But more importantly, also importantly, is the fact that there's a shortage of goods out there, and people who wanted to buy cars, have to wait a little bit longer. The key thing for us, though, we think there's enough liquidity out there that middle line, that total line, can continue to grow at a very robust rate, continuing to pressure global supply chains as they attempt to correct themselves. Next slide, please. I thought I would just take a quick little detour here and just to show you, a little microcosm of this issue of, strong demand, growing demand, constrained supply, and how that really impacts prices and how it may not be resolved quickly. And we and do that microcosm in terms of the housing sector. We've seen housing sales just soar during the pandemic. We know the story there, right? People working from home, they needed a bigger abodes. They wanted to move, in less dense areas. So from the urban to the suburban, to the exurban, to the rural, some of the hottest real estate markets were in rural areas across the country. And needless to say, that hoovered up all of the available supply of homes. So you end up with this imbalance in real estate. I talked to a lot of realtors across the country, and they worry about business being down, not because the demand isn't there. There's no product to be sold. And of course, and we all know the remedy to that. Next slide, please. We just keep building more homes, and that's exactly what we've been doing. But you can see where the constraints begin to impact here. Currently, if you look at the level of homes under construction, they are the highest they've been in 50 years, almost 50 years, even higher during the housing bubble we had that led to the Great Recession. So it's taking longer to build a house. Why? Because materials are taking longer to get to the job site. Workers are, harder to find. So it's just simply taking longer. And because it's taking longer, builders are still, seeking their permits. But if you look at the amount of permits that they're sitting around in their portfolio that they haven't really started to dig in holes yet for, they're also at a record high. So you have these, strong demand, limited, supply owing to these constraints. And what's the net result? You don't have to be an economist to understand what happens there. Next slide, please. What you're seeing is record high increases in home prices. It's kind of funny, we thought back, that in the last cycle, if we saw these kind of home price increases, we all be worried people are getting in over their heads, speculation, and there clearly is a little bit of speculation, a little bit of people getting over their heads. But the fact is, this is legitimate, demand exceeding supply, and the supply being constrained because of the pandemic and other factors. So, we think demand is going to remain relatively robust, sturdy, if you'd like, over the next several years. The millennials that, are now in that sort of part of their lives where they expect to be into the home ownership part of it. And let's face it, if you had plans to buy a house in the next year, two or three, you might as well bite the bullet and buy it sooner rather than later, because in 1 or 2 years, 3 years time, that house may be 10 or 20 or, 25% higher than what it is right now. The key thing is, though, this house price inflation, very small part of, relatively small part of the economy, does ripple through into the inflation metrics. It ripples through into how much rents go up, and importantly, owner's equivalent rent, which is, an important component of the CPI, and also even home insurance premiums. If your home is worth more, you're going to have to pay more to insure it. So as some of these other supply bottleneck pressures fade, we're going to continue to get inflation pressures coming from the housing sector. Next slide. Okay, and getting back to the demand side, okay, so get away from this little microcosm. Consumer spending remains strong. We think business investment also going to remain strong. Again, it has been strong. You know, we've seen, particularly on the intellectual property side and the equipment side, very strong growth in outlays. And a large part of that is a spillover from labor shortages, and the businesses are automating while they can, investing in IT, other kinds of technology in order to become more efficient. More importantly, to mitigate the impact of labor shortages. And one area of the economy which has lagged behind, obviously, is on the structure side. And, you know, we're still building more, you know, warehouses and, you know, data centers. Admittedly, we're not building any new hotels or restaurants just yet. But where the weakness of that really is in the oil sector, where oil production remains well below where it was before. And quite frankly, I doubt whether anytime soon we'll be returning back to the sort of peak oil production we had in America before the pandemic. Next slide. Well, if you're worried about infrastructure outlays and general construction outlays lagging behind the economy, don't have to worry, because the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act is going to add some, at least it's touted to add some $1.2 trillion of spending over the next 5 to 7 years. Now, one thing about politicians that do like to embellish things just a little bit, and there really isn't $1.2 trillion of new spending going on there. It's more like $550 billion. Some of the money that Congress always does approve anyway for surface transportation, which they do every 5 years or every 6 years, depending on, you know, the situation, they kind of roll that into the infrastructure bill to make it look a little bigger than otherwise would be. Oh, well, fair enough. But even at $550 billion, you know, over 5 years, that's still almost 3% of GDP going to spread out over that period. And, fixing bridges to internet up there, to upgrades to our utilities infrastructure. So there's a lot to go on. So again, you know, yes, we may deal with some of the shortages we're having on building materials, but quite frankly, the demand is not going to be going away anytime soon. And therefore prices, may continue to go up and definitely won't be returning back to they were before. Next slide, please. Last piece of the puzzle is we are expecting U.S. exports to pick up. Last year we saw the trade deficit hit a record high, as the fact that U.S. growth was much stronger than the growth in most of our trading partners. And as a result, we ended up importing more than we were exporting, and it caused this record deficit. Looking ahead to this year, we think a lot of these countries are going to catch up, like Canada and Mexico particularly, which are the two largest export markets for the U.S. And that will help sort of turn the trade deficit around. Still elevated, but at least no longer hitting those record highs. So if you go to the next slide and we kind of sum up everything, the outlook for a still sturdy consumer spending, a legacy of still, high outlays by the government, very, strong business outlays, decent export growth, all those things added together, and we're looking for continued sturdy expansion in the economy going forward. Now, the first quarter, as I alluded to before, it's not going to look good. We think, we're looking about 1% annualized growth, again, reflecting the impact of Omicron on absenteeism and just people pulling back temporarily from going to restaurants and things like that. But it's also reflecting a little bit the end of the expanded child tax credit, which, at $15 or $16 billion every month was adding, a little bit of extra oomph to consumer spending. However, we do think once we get over, that little headwind or big headwind, but still temporary headwind, we'll back to 3-4% growth for the middle quarters of this year before we sort of tuck in just under 3% on average. We're looking for growth around 3.5% this year, 2.5% for next year. And, 2.5 may seem a bit slow compared to where we've been, particularly with near 7% in the fourth quarter alone. But keep in mind that the speed limit for the U.S. economy is roughly just under 2%. So anything above that noticeably is still, a relatively good performance. And it means that any kind of inflation pressures that exist in the economy, are going to continue to percolate a little bit until we get growth a little closer to our run rate, which is roughly around, again, just around 2% or slightly below. Now, even though the overall economy is doing well, as we all know, it's not the same thing. And when you look at the individual sectors and industries of the economy, if you go to the next slide, please. people are calling this the K-shaped recovery. There are certain industries that are doing exceptionally well, others that are still lagging behind. You know, of this, and by the way, these figures are for the third quarter. We don't have yet the fourth quarter figures by industry, just for the national economy. But all of these will probably have improved somewhat when they come out for the fourth quarter. But for leading the parade, you know, are all the sectors that were very amenable to work from home. And in particular, the one that garnered the most support as technology was adopted more rapidly during the pandemic was the information sector, finance and insurance also leading the parade. You know, we had, you know, up until recently, we had record stock markets. We had this booming housing sector, which all bodes well for that sector. Agriculture was a lot higher up the rankings earlier in the recovery, but it sort of faded a little back because of the drought experienced in the Midwest. And then finally, goods production is in there, as you would expect, given the huge demand we've seen. On the other side of the ledger, the weakness are all those crowd-dependent sectors, arts, entertainment, and recreation, food services and accommodation, the transportation side of transportation and warehousing. Warehousing is doing exceptionally well, but not the transportation side of that sector. And of course, the mining sector, which includes oil, lagging behind because we simply are not producing as much oil as we did before the pandemic. Next slide, please. The kind of growth we are expecting, above potential growth, will continue to tighten up the labor market. We're expecting by the end of the summer, we will recover all the jobs lost during the recession. And by the end of this year and into next year, we'll be looking at unemployment rates below where we were before the pandemic. And we think as you know, this year unfolds, you know, that the Fed is going to feel, you know, they are, as I've already indicated, they're well on their way to achieving one of their goals of maximum employment. Not quite there exactly yet, but we're well on the way there. And in fact, the ability to get there is actually jeopardized now by high inflation. And therefore the Fed is maybe, you know, still has maximum employment in mind, but wants maximum employment over the long haul. And the only way you're gonna get that is by ensuring that inflation does not get out of hand in the short haul. All right, so next slide, please. And that's exactly what's kind of happened. You know, the risk to price stability have increased quite significantly. As I mentioned at the outset of my presentation, you know, we're looking for inflation to crest this winter and during the spring begin to ebb a little bit. Now, we still get the benefit, you know, the disinflationary benefit of the demographics and aging society. We get the benefit of globalization, not as much as it was before the pandemic and the trade war, but nevertheless, you know, re-globalization, if you'd like, will continue to exert a bit of disinflationary pressure. And of course, technological change, which in fact has been accelerated because of the pandemic. A new thing I think has entered into sort of the more secular trends affecting inflation, and that is sort of climate change and carbon pricing. I think that's gonna be something that's gonna add to the longer term upward pressure on prices. Give you a quick example. You know, the last I checked, there were five separate bills being bandied about in Congress that as part of them would introduce a carbon border adjustment, a border carbon adjustment, which would mean goods coming into America would have some kind of tax on them to reflect the fact that not all countries have the same standards as the U.S. And the U.S. doesn't even have a national carbon price yet. All right. So, you know, we do think that when the dust settles the end of this year, we'll probably get inflation rates under 4%. And by the end of next year, back under 3%. But quite frankly, that assumes that the Fed does the right thing in the interim. Because if they don't, we won't get that kind of outcome. Next slide, please. And in fact, you know, some of you that follow the Fed, they've really changed their tune over the past several months. And they basically said blatantly, our goal here is to prevent higher inflation from becoming entrenched. And why are they worried about that? For two reasons. Number one, you know, as I mentioned to you before, we're starting to see expectations and behavior being influenced by current high rates of inflation. People are a little bit doubtful that it's going to go back to 2% in a hurry or under 2% where we had it before. And I'll give you a little interesting fact is that, you know, we're looking at 40-year highs in inflation. You know, 51% of Americans are under the age of 40, which means that the slight majority of the population are seeing the highest inflation rates they have seen in their entire lifetimes. How can that not influence your behavior and expectations just a little bit? Moreover, you have sort of older Americans that remember the days of double-digit inflation or are currently on fixed incomes that often worry about inflation for legitimate reasons. How can your expectations and your behaviors not be influenced by what we're seeing now? The Fed wants to assure you that you don't have to worry about it. We've got the situation in check, and they're going to act. The other thing is become apparent, and you've taken this away from my presentation, is that it's become very clear that the bottleneck driven inflation is not going to be adequately checked until we deal with the demand side of the equation. Basically, we got to try and curb demand a little bit. Think of housing, curb demand a little bit by raising interest rates. And in fact, that is why the Fed has said that they are prepared, they are poised to start tightening by next meeting. And for my last slide, next one, please. Might as well finish off on what our Fed call is. And by the way, you know, the Fed call, if some of you may follow our forecast, have changed quite a lot, as it has for many shops. And we're expecting, the beginning of liftoff in March, three consecutive rate hikes in mid-March, early May, and then mid-June, and then move to a quarterly pattern. We think we'll get this rates going up until we reach the midpoint of the FOMC's longer-term rate, or just roughly around 2.5%. I haven't talked about it yet, but the Fed has also signaled that that it's going to a lot sooner than what they had done the previous episode, that they will begin to shrink their massive balance sheet that they built up as they printed money to pay for all those bonds that have been buying to keep interest rates low. And we think that runoff, or what people call quantitative tightening, will occur as early as July. But the net risk for us is that we will see those interest rates rise in the runoff at even a faster rate sooner than what we had previously. And of course, with the Fed acting, plus higher inflation, plus those persistently large budget deficits still nagging at us, all suggest that long-term interest rates will rise as well. All right, I'm going to stop right here. Go to the next slide, please. And start thinking about some questions for the next several minutes. And I'm just looking here. Some came over the chat. First question that came out here was, has the stimulus affected demand and prices as much as supply? You know what? If I had to pick, I would say it's 50-50. I think demand has been just as powerful an influence on what we've seen. Maybe at most, I think it would maybe 60 for supply, 40% for demand. So it's roughly about equal shares. And it's been so profound. And you hear that with a lot of the businesses I speak to. And it's like the shortages, the way they just keep popping up. And people liken it to a game of whack-a-mole, which, you play at the carnival, right? As soon as, you hammer down one mole or one, bottleneck pressure or one shortage, another one pops up. I'll give you a quick example. The auto sector. Been worried about microchips for quarters and quarters and quarters. You know what the latest issue is? Shortages of magnesium. Magnesium is used to harden aluminum in the production process. And there's now, issues with respect to magnesium supply. Again, whack that mole down. All right. The second question, what policy changes may the government make to encourage people to remain in work? Oh, that's interesting. Obviously we have an issue here with labor force participation. Well, firstly, we got to get the pandemic under wraps. And I think we're probably heading in a position here where, people will feel a lot more comfortable from a health perspective, at least, rejoining the labor force. The other issue, though, has been capacity in childcare spaces. A lot of childcare workers, have been getting sick. A lot of facilities have closed. So capacity is not where it was before. Now, I think it was dropped, if I recall, in the latest incarnation of a Build Back Better. But at one point, there was a policy on the table, a measure on the table to try to help support affordable childcare across the country. And I think, you know, that is a critical component of increasing participation of parents and women in the economy. And the other thing of that too, quite frankly, is dealing with immigration. I know we try and do this every several years, you know, and finally get, economically beneficial immigration reform. We seem to get there, then we pull back. And I think that's become critically important longer term for the U.S. economy. And these are the kind of thing I think the policy moves that will pay off. The other one is, in the event we don't get the kind of labor force participation or population growth, is to invest in productivity enhancing policies. And I do think for the infrastructure bill, for example, you don't like seeing $1.2 trillion of more government spending, but it's government spending earmarked for infrastructure, which of course tends to improve the grow the economic pie, so we can grow faster down the road without having inflation. Next question. What extent is the improvement of the U.S. economy at risk of continuing strength of the U.S. dollar? Good question. A couple things. Obviously, improving exports in a shrinking trade deficit is part of the driver of growth over the next little while. And to the extent you get a strong U.S. dollar, it does dampen that somewhat. And so it's obviously not positive for growth. The other aspect too, which is a little bit unsettling, at least from a risk standpoint, is a strong U.S. dollar is not only looked upon favorably by other countries around the world, and in many emerging markets, they're dealing with inflation rates that are unacceptably high for them. They've already started raising, interest rates, in Mexico, for example. And that strong U.S. dollar tends to be a problem for them, which of course you begin to worry about, issues about, financial contagion and things like that, which of course is a risk. So, obviously a stronger U.S. dollar is not an overall benefit to a robust recovery. The next question, good one. What is the major reason for the decrease in oil production? Considering we're living with $90 oil almost, why don't we ramp this up more? Well, I do think the oil companies themselves are treating things a little bit differently. Let's face it, the current administration is not as amenable to the oil sector as it was, as the previous one was. And I think, there is more of a, more and more institutional investors are putting on sort of an ESG type lens when they're looking at their investments. And as a result, I think oil companies and explorers and that are being a little more cautious in how they approach development. Now, there's nothing like higher prices to egg on a little bit more production. But I doubt if we get back, which many people believe, back above $100 a barrel for WTI, whether or not we'll even get back yet to the level of oil production that we had previously. And this is not only a U.S. oil production. We're seeing an impact globally on mining output and other oil production, simply because of, again, people are more and more sort of have sort of health concerns, not health, sorry, climate concerns, health for planet concerns, climate concerns. And that is something that is kind of rippling through the global economy. And last question before we turn things back over to Todd, will interest rates dampen housing prices at all? Yes, of course they will. You take off, one thing about markets, when they're drummed tight, which the housing market is, all it takes is a little bit of easing back in demand or a little bit of increasing of supply. And it does address, it does have a disproportionate impact on price inflation. So I do think as we get higher mortgage rates rippling into a softer demand, but still sturdy demand, but softer than it is right now for housing, and those supply eventually do come on stream, when you finally do complete all those homes, that we will get home price inflation cooling off. I do think home prices will continue to run faster than the general inflation rate for the foreseeable future. And with that, there's some more questions, but flipping in an email or whatever, we'll try and get to you as soon as we can. And with that, I'll turn things back over to Todd for some closing comments. Mr. Todd.
Thank you, Michael. I appreciate it. Great questions and dialogue. I'd like to thank you, Michael, again for being here today and for all of our guests. Thanks for taking the time. It means a lot. We appreciate the investment in us. feel free to reach out to your BMO relationship team or myself if you have any additional thoughts or questions. We'd be happy to track it down for you. I'd also encourage you to visit our website, bmoharris.com/commercial, bmoharris.com/commercial, where we share our latest outlooks, either from Michael or others, as well as other thought leadership content. We will be sending you a brief survey from our BMO invites email and would appreciate your anonymous feedback. It will help us to continue to evolve our events as well as our thought leadership so that everything we do is relevant for you. With that, thank you for your time. Thank you for your partnership. And thanks for what you do for us. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thanks, everybody. See ya.